man has continuously been astounded by the great natural wonders of our universe. Talk about the Great Barrier Reefs, the Grand Canyon, the ever-falling Victoria Falls, or even the high and mighty Mount Everest. Yet, in my estimation, nothing captures our curiosity more than the mere fact that the entire planet hangs in a vacuum called outer space. Since we first gained consciousness as a humanity and as a civilization, we have tried to understand what exists in the skies beyond what we can see. In this episode, we are going to try to understand all the efforts of man to understand the world beyond the skies. Talk about Mars exploration, lunar exploration, or even commercial space flight. We'll try to do justice to these topics. This is the Contemporary Science Podcast Show, where we discuss science projects happening across the world. We discuss interesting breakthrough therapies and even groundbreaking technologies that are making waves over the internet. My name is Randy Eti, your host, and I'm here with
Sean Murphy, your co-host.
Stay tuned. So, Sean, I've been the entire airwaves so far, aside artificial intelligence, is what I've been hearing over the news when it comes to technology is space exploration. And when I think about it, one thing, the very first thing that hits me is curiosity. Like, how man is so curious to understand and to explore the world. And I find it so fascinating. And I was reading a little bit about it, and Albert Einstein, one of the greatest scientists, he said that, "I don't see myself to have a special talent, but I am just passionately curious." And this curiosity has led us to do so many things, so many things. And space exploration for me is like the greatest thing that our curiosity has led us to do.
Yeah. It's what amazes me just even approaching this topic is the history of this, because it goes way beyond even, you know, it certainly goes way beyond modern civilization. I remember when I was growing up and going to elementary school and stuff, there was a program that I was in where they really wanted to focus on like Mayan civilizations. And even the Mayans had things to do with developing a calendar system and how they used, you know, pillars and rocks to develop essentially a sundial. Yeah. And then, you know, different figures throughout time, Galileo, Isaac Newton, and discovering, or not discovering, but putting words to what gravity is. Yes. And so it's crazy that it's all tied in since the dawn of, let's say, human consciousness. We're curious about these things that are way beyond our grasp, you know, at each stage.
It's very fascinating. And as you said, it goes way back. Mm-hmm. So even talk about when people used to discuss whether the earth was flat or whether the earth round, whether the earth was at the center of the universe and all other things revolved around the earth, or whether the sun was in the center. Yeah. And it transcended just science to religion, where people were killed for saying that the sun was the center of the earth rather than the earth.
Who was, I don't know if you remember off the top of your head, the scientist that was really involved in that? Do you remember?
What I remember is Galileo Galilei.
Yeah, okay.
That was his name. Yeah. And he, I think his postulate was that the earth is flat. And so everyone knew or thought that the earth was flat. And it took so much work for people to begin to, like, through scientific research and all of that, And with more understanding, we realized that the Earth couldn't be flat.
Yeah. So he contradicted the idea that it was flat? Right.
Yeah. No. So what I know is he said it was flat.
Okay, interesting.
And then other scientists came in and said, it's actually round.
Okay, interesting.
It was spherical, not flat as it was thought. And something I also know is that with some of like the people that helped to get more understanding about the spherical shape of the Earth were people who used to travel across the world overseas.
Right.
And so if it's flat, you wouldn't be able to come back to the exact same point you started.
Mm-hmm.
And you had people who were exploring the world. And first among the people I know is Christopher Columbus.
Mm-hmm.
And he discovered like the U.S., but he traveled the same route and came back to the same point.
Well, this is sort of an interesting tangent, but just that the fact that sailors, the sextant was developed and it utilized the, you know, angle, like it utilizes angles to in stars to determine, you know, the proper course of, you know,
very
where they're going and whatnot. So that's really, really interesting stuff.
And I'll just go for it a bit. So we look at like some of the history of space exploration, what we've been doing over the years to sort of understand what is beyond the skies. And we've done a lot. As a humanity, as a civilization, we have accomplished a lot. And I'll just go through a bit of them, not everything. We couldn't cover everything in this episode. But the first one was in 1957, the Soviet Union. And they sent out Sputnik 1. And Sputnik 1 was a satellite. So this satellite was sent into outer space, and that was like our very first effort into trying to research and learn about what is up there.
Mm-hmm.
And beyond that, in 1961, the Soviet Union again, so there was this man called Yuri Gagarin, who was the very first man to go into outer space, the very first man. And so these people, like, the Soviet Union, I would say, was the very first at that time, like, the world power at that time, trying to, like, so there are these researchers that were trying to lead the way in our understanding of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll just mention a few more. So the U.S. also got into the picture with Alan Shepard, who orbited the Earth. And then we had Alexei Leonov, also who did the first spacewalk. And then we all know about Neil Armstrong.
Yeah.
But what most people don't know is that Neil Armstrong wasn't there alone.
Mm-hmm.
There were actually two people.
Right.
So Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin in 1969 were the first people who landed on the moon. I don't know. Sometimes history is quite unfair to some people because there are actually two people who landed there on the moon. But yeah, that's a short history about space exploration. Now, there are other programs that we'll talk about a bit as we go along in our episode today.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention one quick thing that I learned about with Sputnik and that whole the Soviet process was the Sputnik satellite was launched into low Earth orbit via essentially an intercontinental ballistic missile. So they had developed essentially a weapon to reach the United States if needed, but it was too large, and like the way that they built it wasn't really feasible to actually utilize in a type of like war capacity setting. So then the scientists got permission to launch the satellite. And so what's fascinating is that the space race, in a lot of ways, started through, you know, military developments. And the other kind of wild, like the Soviets, I really respect, like, they just push the limit.
Yeah.
And one funny thing that they would do before they launched Yuri, they launched animals into space. So they launched a couple of dogs, I think, and the U.S. launched a monkey into space. So they were doing wild stuff to determine if a mammal could even survive out there. And I guess that's just, I mean, animal research is a reality of science. So
yeah. And I'm tempted to talk a little bit about animal research, but we will probably veer off course.
Get off
We will just continue with, I think it's an interesting topic to discuss sometime on this show.
Yeah, we should.
We should really look at it. We're just talking initially about how Neuralink got clearance by from the FDA to begin human research. And they had, for quite a number of years, they've been working with animals.
Yeah.
Doing all these animal testing.
Yeah.
So I think it's a huge topic to discuss sometime later. But so I've been looking at lunar exploration, which is the exploration of the moon. And there are other things that we could talk about. We could talk about mass exploration and commercial space flights in general, but that will come sometime later within the episode. But lunar exploration, the question is it possible?
Right.
What are your thoughts
on
that?
So just immediately when you say it, so just to, I guess, address the elephant in the room, there are questions about whether or not the first moon landing was legitimate.
Yes.
And
yes,
I personally have doubts about it. And the reason I say that I have doubts is because, well, first thing, I don't know, but I do have doubts. And the reason is because their technology back then, I do believe that we were able to launch satellites and things like that. But now, after having commercialization of spaceflight, we realize how truly difficult it is. It's extremely difficult. And to think that SpaceX, which is pretty much the cutting edge, still hasn't gone to the moon with humans and put humans on the moon yet, I have hesitancy believing that they did it back then. They could have, and it could have been, I mean, that would be insane. I think that people have gone to the moon after, maybe, but so that it's complicated, right? Because that's a whole thing. So
Yeah. So it's interesting you bring this up, and you could say I'm smiling because I have discussed this with a few friends, and to be honest, this is like a huge debate in so the history about this. And I don't know so much about the history, but what I've learned is that the Soviet Union, during those times where there was strong animosity between the Soviet Union and the US, during those times, the U.S. had all the greatest scientists.
And sorry to cut you off, but that the accumulation of some of the greatest scientists by the U.S. Has its own, honestly, dark history with regards to the Germans that they brought over and that, you know.
Including Albert Einstein and all of that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the U.S. had all of those, these great guys, and to be fighting for like being the first to do something and not being able to do it, and you have your arch rival being able to do it the first time and then the second time using like Yuri Gagarin, as we mentioned earlier, it sort of draws the battle line where there must be a response from the US not just so the battle wasn't just about nuclear or atomic bombs, but it was also about brains, about who is the best, who could get to the moon first.
Yeah.
Right. And so most people, when it comes to the moon landing, talk about this being what fueled people to, or the people in the time to, as it were, for lack of a better word, fake the moon landing.
Right.
And I was watching Neil deGrasse Tyson the other day, and he's an astrophysicist, so mm-hmm. he likes to talk about these things. Mm-hmm. And he was asked just the simple question, is the moon landing, or was the moon landing faked?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, so he didn't give an objective answer. I guess he doesn't know. So what he said was, think about it. We have footage. So this was his answer. Think about it. We have footage that shows the moon landing. People could say it's faked, but think about the effort that will go into faking a moon landing other than actually doing the moon landing. So for him, his argument is that it takes more effort to fake it than to actually do it. And so he doesn't believe that it was faked.
Gotcha.
It would take more effort to be able to convince the entire world that it actually did happen. Yet, we've not seen a replica. We've not seen a repetition of that. Mm-hmm. Like, if you actually did it and you have all the mathematics, the physics, like everything, because these things are documented. So mm-hmm. why haven't we been able to replicate it or repeat it again?
Right.
So that is like the greatest point of contention, that if it's true, why are we still struggling to repeat it?
Mm. And I will say from some of the research that I've done, the cost element is huge. So
mm-hmm. yeah.
I watched an interview with Elon Musk. He was giving sort of like a keynote type speech about Mars exploration, which we'll get into. But he mentioned how expensive it was to send through. This is like his calculations. He believes that it was upwards of $100 billion to get those individuals to the moon in today's money. So because as the Soviet Union collapsed and the drive to pursue that was less at a certain time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think the cost didn't justify going again, because the unfortunate thing about, so the space race is undeniably amazing, and we wouldn't be here with so much technology too was developed out of trying to get to space.
Yes.
Like all this type of computer equipment and all that stuff. But the unfortunate part about it is that because it was so much of a who is better, there was less of an emphasis on what are we trying to figure out about space.
And why are we going there?
Yeah. Now we've entered into a different phase of like, okay, there's very, like we've entered into a space of let's explore space because space is amazing. It's insane that we're on this planet and we have no evidence thus far of something even close to what we have here.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And even talking about why we want to go to space, and we'll get into that a bit. Talk about what NASA is doing, SpaceX. There's an agency called the European Space Agency that we would talk about a bit. And there's another one called the Blue Origin, which was set up by Jeff Bezos.
Yes, yes.
And we will get into that a bit. But what I was trying to understand is the possibility. And I know there are major, major, major challenges that inhibit going to the moon and making or like set it up presence on the moon. Not just visiting and coming back, but actually landing there, staying there for some time and coming back. And what, how these people that will be sent there, what that effect will have on them.
Physically,
like in every way, biologically and all of that. And so it's a huge challenge that these companies that were set up to work to make sure that this becomes possible.
Yeah.
I know it's for me. So to answer the question, I think it's possible.
You know what? I agree with you. I do think it's possible. I think there was a point where it wasn't possible.
Yeah.
And I think the commercialization and the efforts that, you know, SpaceX and I'm sure there's other players around the world that we don't know about who are getting close as well. But because SpaceX is at the forefront, I think that's the most obvious example. But the breakthroughs that they've made with reusability and things like that, I do think it's possible now, which is really exciting. But it's what is so amazing, even and it really is amazing what they were able to do, like way back in the 60s and 70s, it's truly like one of the most difficult problems to solve.
Yes, and I would say being able to do what we plan to do, which is to go and live on Mars, not even to go into Mars, but to even live on the moon, if we are able to do that, that would be like the greatest giant leap that humanity would ever be able to do.
Yeah.
And I end with artificial intelligence also making things so possible now. I think we are even closer than we were ever before.
Yeah.
And I would just go over some of, like, so I wrote down, like, what are the main challenges that, there are a lot of them, but there are three main points that I have curated that I think would, that we would need to find answers to if we, this would be possible. The first one is the fact that the moon has no atmosphere. So we know what the atmosphere does for the Earth. Off the top of my head, I know that the atmosphere we have helps to maintain the temperature on the Earth. Right. And so the we have the glaciers being it's melting now due to climate change and all of that. But the atmosphere is what keeps the ice. And the same atmosphere keeps the heat. And so if we have no atmosphere, that is the first problem. Then the second problem or challenge would be the harsh temperature conditions. So from the Google search I did, it says the high temperatures are like 260 degrees Fahrenheit. So like you could, that's like it can literally melt things. And the lowest temperature is negative 280 Fahrenheit. So imagine living on the moon and experiencing these two temperatures. So to be able to maintain temperature and the energy cost of being able to maintain these temperatures. You know, these are top challenges that we must overcome. And the last one, as I mentioned, are biologically. Like the fact that we would be in the most, we would be in the most severe part of gravity, because gravity changes. At some part of the world, it's exactly 10 meters per second square. In some other parts of the world, it's 9.8 meters per second square. As you go deeper, like as you go closer to the core of the Earth, gravity is stronger. As you go outside, it's weaker. So if you are living on the moon, the gravity there will be different. And so the response it has on your biological system would also be different. These are great challenges.
The biological challenges, and I'm very interested in this obstacle because I just know from the studies that I've done myself with being interested in pursuing the medical field and whatnot, and also being interested in this idea of human optimization. The purpose of expanding to, let's say, have a base on the moon, or as crazy as it may sound, mm-hmm. to have a base on Mars where we're expanding human civilization to what they like to call interplanetary species. The advantage, or the purest goal of that, is to allow humans to continue living and prevent human extinction in the case that a severe extinction event may occur, because there have been throughout history these events of cataclysmic asteroid impacts, volcanic eruptions, and unfortunately, with the introduction of nuclear war, that's yeah. a concern as well. So the foundation is, we want to allow humans to live and thrive and give humanity its best shot at continuing to do so. This idea of doing it through space may seem unrealistic to some, but I do think that it's that the pursuit of it is worthwhile. So getting back to the moon, it's the consequences of decreased bone density, decreased muscle mass, changes in blood flow, because your gravity, our heart and muscular and our vascular system has adapted to gravity. So the way that the heart pumps, how our veins expand and contract, that all is operating at peak potential if you're a healthy individual under gravitational conditions. As we change that, in which the moon has very little gravity, that's going to cause issues, and it causes issues. The moon, so where the International Space Station is low Earth orbit, essentially. It's in a steady state of free fall. So I think we could just real quick clarify what a lot of people don't realize is that the space station is not in zero gravity. It's still being greatly affected by the Earth's gravity, but it's moving at a rate of speed at which the Earth is pulling the space station down, and the rate at which it's moving around the Earth is suspending it in a constant state of free fall. So the zero gravity is actually just a condition of free fall. But on the moon, and with under those conditions, astronauts experience decreased bone density and muscle mass loss, changes in their eyes, changes in, which is why they spend an extreme amount of time exercising while they're there. These things are going to be increased when you're that far away. Now you're at the moon, where there's even less influence of gravity. And then the other factors you mentioned, like the atmosphere not protecting us from the sun's radiation, is a huge thing. So, but I think that it's possible. It's just that we're going to have to push the limits of, you know, developing suits, what changes in, for lack of a better phrase, like shelter, that is going to become a totally different thing. So it's it's a pursuit that I have a question for you. So I was talking to someone recently, and they were like, their position on this whole topic is, why are we investing this much time, effort, and energy into going to space when there's problems in other countries, and there's poverty, and there's famine? What does pursuing space or why is that a worthwhile venture when we have so many problems that we could be solving on Earth?
That's that's a very, very good question. And I think this question is a question that we could, not us, but like world leaders could discuss in a UN summit.
Yeah.
So this is a $1 billion question that we can't exhaust in a podcast room. I'm telling you. But we could share our thoughts on what we think. And to be honest, I think the existence of problems on this earth would not cease. Like, the problems that we face, we would continue to face them. And there are some problems that we would face that are not owed to natural disasters or, like, things happening where people do not have control over. There are some of the problems that we create for ourselves. That by finding solutions beforehand, we could be able to solve some of these problems. And an example would be these civil wars that happen. And in Africa, we've had a lot of those where there's a civil war, Rwanda, for instance. And Rwanda is doing great now. But when they had the civil war back then, it didn't just end in a war. Like, it wasn't just a war. It ended in a lot of famine and poverty.
Yeah.
And there were people who had to leave their countries into neighboring countries.
Yeah.
Those countries had to build capacity to receive them as refugees.
Yeah.
Like, there are rippling effects that come from just that one war that happened. Right.
Mm.
And so then the world, like other world leaders or other countries, will then have to put in resources to be able to help these people to provide shelter, food, and all of those things.
Yep.
Even healthcare aid to help them to be able to overcome or to go through that problem into a state where they are okay to work things out for themselves. And so my answer is, the existence of these problems should not stop us from exploring other things.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of things that we are doing to make sure that these problems are solved in the way that is possible. And what people say around why we are spending so much time, efforts, money, pumping so much of energy into space exploration, several other things that people think that are not necessary, right? I think the reason why people are so concerned about it is because they feel that if those resources and energy and work was channeled into solving these problems, we would not have them.
Yeah.
Or we could solve them at a better, at a faster rate.
Yeah.
But then it will also surprise you that when you solve those, we ourselves will come up with more problems.
Yes. And I completely agree that you have a very, like, we have very similar stances on this, which is, I think, I definitely respect that position. And I think there is some truth, or there's a value in considering that position and understanding, like, okay, we still need to focus on problems here on Earth, but there are a very large number of people working on those problems, but those problems, human conflict problems, are especially hard to solve, because even when, let's say, a better off country goes and says, I'm going to make it my mission to help this country, sometimes this country is like, we don't need your help.
Exactly what I was about to say. they will just say, hey, we don't need you here.
Yeah.
And I don't want us to veer off topic, but but I'll just mention this in passing about, like, what's happening in Ukraine and Russia and all of that. The Russians, from what I've read, are fighting for this because of the influence or the perceived influence that they feel the U.S. would have over Ukraine once Ukraine joins NATO.
Yes.
And so because they don't want that to happen, that is why they are resisting it. And that is what has ended in the war. And so if the U.S. doesn't tread on that path, probably the war wouldn't happen.
Yes.
So, as you mentioned, human conflict and all of that, and I don't want to like go into that a bit so much,
right.
But generally, problems always exist.
Yeah.
And we as humanity have tried to solve these problems, and we are still doing them.
Yes.
So it's not like you put an end to those efforts.
And it's not like if you invest in this, that this stops.
Exactly.
And I think the reason that we fear that is because it's hard for us to grasp just how big the Earth is, just how capable humans are, but also it's hard for us to grasp the sheer numbers of humans on Earth.
Yeah.
There's over 7 billion humans
on
Earth.
We're approaching 8 billion, actually.
And so it's very difficult for us to grasp that amount of humans and that amount of consciousness is capable of doing more than one thing. Like, you could invest hundreds of billions, probably upwards of trillions of dollars in space exploration and still have people doing this over here.
Yeah.
But, and so I think we have a very similar take, which is that it's still worthwhile. And I think history shows, too, when we're pursuing these types of things that we truly don't have answers to, like the challenges that we're going to be facing with space exploration, solutions that pop up are effective in more than just space exploration. There could be a technology that we develop from solving a challenge on the moon that does allow us to provide clean energy or some new solution with water production that could then help impoverished areas. There's more, like, we can't underestimate the ripple effect of these types of things.
Yes, and talking about all of these challenges that exist, and I read that one of the major challenges, and you mentioned one, which is like mass extinction that happens every now and then in the history of our Earth. And when we look at those challenges, another one that comes to mind is the general climate that happens. And I know like mass extinctions happen when, not all the time, but sometimes when a meteorite hits the Earth, for instance, and the size and the magnitude of that meteorite causes a change, a drastic change in our climate and makes it too severe for some species to continue living. And that's what happened to the dinosaurs and all of that. But according to some of these institutions that have been set up, NASA, SpaceX, Blue Origin, and all of that. Mm-hmm. And I'll speak a little bit to Blue Origin. And so, because they are like the lead together with NASA on lunar exploration. And when their tagline is for the benefit of Earth. And what they say is the reason why space exploration and we living on the moon is important is to provide an alternative to some of the most dangerous research work and activities that we do on the Earth. So we are doing a lot of, so for instance, people are doing nuclear armor testing. We are doing a lot of things like these factories that release or emit so much carbon monoxide gas and carbon dioxide gases into the atmosphere. Those companies are important to have. Like, they are, we can't underestimate their importance on this Earth. And so what we could do is to take those companies up there into space, set their base up there on the moon.
Yeah.
And then whatever that is done there, probably by doing that, we're able to get clean energy.
Mm.
That energy comes to the Earth and it's used here, but it's not produced here, but on the moon.
Yeah. And one, and this is just something that I've thought about. I haven't looked into companies, whether companies are talking about this, but the landfills here on Earth are a big thing too.
Yeah.
If we could find a way to start, and of course, an efficient way that actually produces a net benefit, you know, we do have to be careful, like in pursuing these things, sometimes it appears that it's beneficial, but it's actually not. So let's assume that it's a net beneficial result. Imagine if we would be able to take these landfills and start shipping that waste out into space. And I know that it may seem crude to do that, but the important thing to realize about space is it's literally infinite. Like, to our understanding, space is infinite. So really, we don't need to be concerned.
It's just space.
Yeah.
It's just space.
Yeah. It's, so, yeah.
Yeah. So just the thought about that, it fascinates me so much. When growing up, I would read about these things and I'm like, I try to close my eyes and try to envision it. So, like, the Earth, which is so huge, is finite.
Mm-hmm.
So I used to think about them like, the Earth that I see that is so huge, so massive, is finite.
Mm-hmm.
And there are other planets or planetary bodies that are way more massive than the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And in our solar system, in our universe here, we have the sun, which is so huge, but in other solar systems and other universes, the sun is something like a speck.
Yeah.
It blows my mind.
It's thinking about those things, it truly is almost impossible to wrap your head around, because the scale doesn't make sense. Yeah. Like, you know, you can see here just a little representation, and, you know, just how truly massive the sun is and compared to Earth. We don't fully grasp how vast space is. And I think the vastness of space is too what gives the Earth, what makes the Earth so special. The fact that, yes, that space is so vast, and that chemistry and science and physics, for all we know, those laws and biological laws, you know, there's laws of physics, there's biological laws in some ways. Those laws, let's assume, are happening elsewhere, but there's only one Earth. So, you know, the topic of creation and evolution and science and religion and the back and forth, I think why space is so amazing is because it goes, whatever you believe, there's only one Earth.
Exactly.
But there's nothing stopping physics and science from happening elsewhere. It just happened to happen here.
Yes.
And so just exploring that unknown is very, it's in our DNA to want to do that.
And one thing that captures my attention, talking about the various programs that have led to space exploration being possible. And I'll name a few, but there is this one that I would like us to go a little deeper on, which is the Artemis project.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll go over that a bit. But before that, there was the China Lunar Exploration Program. So China has also been working on this. It seems like all the huge economies are all invested into this. And I think it's good. It's good that they are all invested into this. And so the China Lunar Exploration Program was set up to also go to the moon, explore the moon, and possibly set up a base there where human beings could actually live there.
Yeah.
And they have a target of like getting there by 2029. There is SpaceX Starship program that is also happening.
Mm-hmm.
There is the Gateway program,
mm-hmm.
Which is NASA. So NASA represents the US, and then the ESA, which is the European Space Agency, that are also working together. And there are a few other countries that are also involved.
Yeah.
And then there is the Artemis project. And these are not the only ones. There are several of them.
Mm-hmm.
But the Artemis project fascinates me a lot because they have a goal of setting up a base on the moon by next year.
Yeah.
2024.
Yeah.
And so what seems to be so far away is going to, if they are able to do it, mm-hmm. if everything goes as planned, by 2024, we will have another time where we could write in history, like we did for Neil Armstrong.
Mm-hmm.
We could write in history that these were the first people to not just visit the moon, but to stay on the moon for a given period of time.
Yeah.
This alone fascinates me so much.
Yeah. It's, what's wild is to be in this time where not only is the AI revolution happening, but now we are actually, we're in this exponential curve, we're experiencing this exponential curve, and we're alive to see these things happening, where humans are actually going to be within our lifetime positioning themselves on other planetary objects, essentially, where, you know, to think that humans are no longer exclusively earthbound, it's not a earthbound civilization anymore, it's expanded beyond that, is really fascinating. And one concern, or what I really hope, and this is going, I believe that we will face challenges in this realm, and I'd be interested to hear your take, is like, other countries are pursuing this. Well, science has, fortunately, because of the nature of who scientists are, they want to they value pursuing things and finding things out for the most part more than they do the differences, more than they care about the differences between one another.
Yeah.
But we will inevitably face obstacles in terms of whose territory is where on the moon, and, you know, who's working with who, and how all of the economics behind that are going to work out. The Gateway program, I think, is a great way to do that. And I think the ideal situation would be that we can establish that hub up in space where other countries can dock, and there can be almost like a totally different relationship where countries will become less of a thing, because you're not on Earth anymore. You're in space. You're on the moon. So we're going to see changes in relationships too. Like, this is going to be bigger than just science. We're going to enter into a different territory socially too.
I mean, you bring up a very, very good point in discussing territorial supremacy.
Mm-hmm.
People, and you see, I feel because we are human, and just by mere human frailty, like to relate one thing to the other, draw similarities and relations between one thing or the other. And so people would like to continue how they were living here on Earth up there in space. Like, and we are talking in terms of once everything is possible, we are able to set up a space there and live there like we live here. It's going to be a great thing. Like, for me, I feel this would be a big challenge. As a matter of fact, this would be greater than all the challenges we would face, or even trying to live on the moon.
Mm-hmm.
The challenge of trying to get peace to reign between all these countries that are pursuing it would be the greatest challenge we would face.
Yep.
And the way I look at it is, to be able to solve this, we must take it as a fresh start.
Yes, yes.
Our opportunity to start afresh.
Yeah.
To wipe out the slate and begin as if we are new. As a matter of fact, we are new there. We mm-hmm. are new on the moon. And we would go further in later parts of the episode. Probably we would have to have a part two of
this. Yeah, for sure.
Where we discuss some of the biggest technologies that we have been able to manufacture mm-hmm. or invent to make this possible. And look at what mass exploration is, because we've not even talked about that. We've not even gone into mass exploration.
Right, we haven't even discussed really the details of the Artemis yes. program yet.
Yes, but what I'm thinking is, before we even, because all of these things going to the moon is geared towards setting us up to be able to get to Mars.
Yes.
So living on the moon, for most of these researchers, the scientists, the politics, the money that is going into it, is so that once we are able to get comfortable living there on the moon,
mm-hmm.
that the ideas and the research and the data we are able to collect about ourselves and about how life would be on the moon would help us to be able to successfully take that on to living on Mars.
It's like a trial period.
Exactly.
The moon is going to be acting as our, it's like a lab experiment that we're mm-hmm. going to be taking to yeah. the next phase.
Yeah.
Which I really like that we have that opportunity. And what I mean by that is, it's wild that we have a moon that we can get to and use as a launching pad for future
exploration. And that is a gateway program, actually.
Yes,
that's
yes.
what they hope to do. But one thing that I was thinking about is how life would be there. And we'll get to the Artemis program in a bit. But I watched this movie that kind of gave me a sneak peek into what life could be living on the moon and even going into Mars, which is Dune. So
yes.
I watched Dune.
Oh, it's one of my favorites.
They would have the sequel coming up in November.
Soon, yeah.
In November this year, and I'll be watching it. But preparing for this podcast, I just went to like recap. So I watched a few of the trailers. I'd watched it when it came in 2021, but I decided to like watch a bit of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm mesmerized by the lifestyle, the like how they were living there. And just to think about if that could be our fate, like if that is how we're going to live, then the issue about like how you were mentioned territorial politics or mm-hmm. problems that could arise. One of the problems that could arise would be the differences in the kind of people who live on Earth and those who live on the moon and those who live on Mars.
Interesting.
And how we, and even thinking about whether we would take it a point further or a step further to, as it were, move from one planet to the other.
Yeah.
To like alternate.
Yes.
So like I could decide to go to Mars and live there for a year, or even pay a visit and come back once yeah. our technology gets better.
Yeah.
And how life for people who live on the Earth will be different from those who live on Mars.
Yeah.
Or even on the moon.
One thing, just along the lines of what you were saying, how there's going to be different groups. And at first, it's going to be very few people. I mean, this is going to start really small, and it's going to be, for the most part, extremely skilled individuals, because that's who is going to be able to essentially survive, and because they're going to have to be able to do many different jobs. So, you know, not only are they going to be astronauts, but a lot of times it's going to be, you know, mechanical engineers, chemists. They're yeah. going to want physicians up there to obviously treat people yeah. if that. So it's going to start small, but let's go forward a little bit to when there are larger groups of people. Let's say a larger base on the moon, where there's like a decent workforce or a decent population. Let's just say like 50 people, or and then eventually way farther in the future where there's even people on Mars. I'm interested in the differences in two ways. One is actual biological evolution.
Mm-hmm.
Because the changes that are inevitably going to happen physically to humans who do this, because there will be people who go and stay for long periods of time. Right now, it's difficult for astronauts to stay in space for extended period of time. I think the longest time is maybe a little bit over a year. And that individual, I forget, I know Yuri stayed for a long time in space, mm-hmm. but there's other American scientists who are astronauts who have stayed in space for quite a long time. And they do experience a lot of side effects.
Yeah.
Significant loss of bone density, significant loss of muscle mass. And just from the biological perspective, those changes can impact brain function. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have to solve a lot of problems in terms of optimizing humans so that, because a huge part of succeeding in these ventures is going to be making sure that our mental function is at peak performance, because we're going to always have to be inventing things, fixing things. So making sure the body and mind is functioning properly is going to be of utmost priority.
Yeah.
So that's one way, is like, how is the human body going to change? Because it will change. And what is that going to look like? Because one thing that's just kind of silly and funny to think about, let's say we took you and I and we went to Mars. I think Mars gravity is about 30% of Earth or something like that. So we'd be very strong. We'd be able to lift extremely heavy objects. We'd, you know, but that sounds all fine and good until the resistance begins to, you know, compromise our body. So, but then the other aspect, as kind of demonstrated in Dune, is like, you're going to develop cultural differences,
exactly.
which is very interesting. So, you know, I think the future is so, there's so much unknown. It's really, I think, it's just fun to think about. It's fascinating.
We could prepare for a lot of things, but we can't prepare for everything.
No, yeah.
So we are able to prepare and plan and work things out, even try to solve the problems before they arise. And some of the things we are doing is like making sure that all the things that sustain human life are present in those places that we want to go.
Yes.
And so scientists have found some ice glaciers on the moon mm-hmm. that tells them that, okay, we can get water on the moon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, talk about oxygen. There are all of these things that they are working out to make sure that we have all of these, we are able to survive on there. But I don't think we can prepare for every single thing. Because think about it. Humanity, like our biological system, had to adapt over several years.
Yeah.
If Darwin's evolution theory is something to go by, we could learn that we had to adapt
mm-hmm.
to all the changes in our environment to be able to get to the state we are.
Yeah.
And so we can't just prepare for something and hope that once we get there, this preparation will meet the demands that we have. And then all of a sudden, we are okay to continue living. It will take so long, mm-hmm. so much time to mm-hmm. be able to live comfortably there. And some of the problems that will arrive would be solved by probably the third generation after us, or the fourth or the fifth generation after us.
Yes.
And to be honest, I don't think we can even fathom what the problems would be.
Yeah.
Because some of the problems we have are just things that we are, even on this earth, we are still learning.
Of course.
So there are things that are called like great wonders of the world that we still think about, that are still baggle scientists till today. Right. But moving forward a bit, I just want to read this short paragraph that I found on the NASA website, and it's intriguing, about the Artemis project. And once posting this, I'll add this so our viewers and our audience could see it and read it for themselves.
Great.
But it says, in quotes, after 20 years of continuously living in low Earth orbits, we are now ready for the next great challenge of space exploration, the development of a sustained presence on and around the moon, unquote, said NASA Administrator Jim Bridenstine. For years to come, Artemis will serve as our North Star as we continue to work toward even greater exploration of the moon, where we'll demonstrate key elements needed for the first human mission to Mars. So as I was saying, the Artemis program or project, as others call it, is geared towards taking people to the moon. But the end goal is to find out what the problems would be and to set us up for living on Mars. And it continues and says, on the surface, the core elements for a sustained presence would include an emphasis on mobility to allow astronauts to explore more of the moon and conduct more science. And there are three main points that they mentioned. Number one, a lunar terrain vehicle called the LTV will transport crew around the landing zone on the moon. The second point, the habitable mobility platform would enable crews to take trips across the moon lasting up to 45 days. And the third point is a lunar foundation surface habitat would house as many as four crew members on shorter surface stays. And these things intrigue me so much. So even the thinking about the very first point, a lunar terrain vehicle. And I don't know how it will look like, but it will definitely be something that would be able to ply the roads on the moon. And I don't know how it's going to, like, I'm just trying to think about how life would be there, as we mentioned, these cultural differences of being able to travel around the moon, set up a base there, live there. And they are talking about a lunar foundation surface habitat to house people living on the moon.
Yeah.
And it's a great thing to even think about like how to be able to get people to live on the moon. It's fascinating. And sometimes I'm just short of words. It feels like we just have to wait and see what happens.
Yeah, I think that is a really big part of it. What I like to think about too is, from a design perspective, what the structure is going to look like. I like to sort of visualize, you know, if I was an astronaut, what would I want the structure to be? Like, how would I want that? What would the feeling I would want it to be like, you know? And I could only imagine the sense of pride that you would have, it, especially if, like, let's say there's a person from China, a person from Russia, and then, you know, U.S. astronauts and, you know, that group being up there with those individuals and being able to share that experience with them, I could only imagine the sense of pride and camaraderie that you would have with people, because you're in such a treacherous environment. So you have to collaborate on such a intimate level to make sure that you survive.
Yeah.
And you know, that really is what fascinates me is that those beginning, like, the word for it is, you know, the pioneers that are going to be going up here, up to the moon and doing those things, that, those stories that are going to come from that. That's what's fascinating to me.
Yeah. And just moving forward a bit to mass exploration. Mm. And I've been so enthused about things that concern like going into Mars and living there. And we know Elon Musk is like one of the strongest, I would say, like people who are fighting so hard for this to happen.
Yeah.
It's like there's a sense of urgency in trying to get to Mars.
Yeah. I found just the other day, I found an interview of him in 2004.
Oh.
Talking about being a multiplanetary species, as he likes to call it. I think, you know, he's popularized that term of like, and he's sort of single in a lot of ways, especially for, I would say, our young, like, individuals our age. He is popularized the concept of being an interplanetary a multiplanetary species.
Yes. And you kind of, so before my deep interest in this topic, it kind of felt so distant to me, like something I don't really care about. I mean, if it happens, fine. If it happens, I don't really care. But after like thinking about it, getting some interest in it and reading about it, and what fueled my interest in it basically is like Elon Musk. Mm. And I've been following him because it's like, I would say the Nikola Tesla of our days.
Yeah.
In terms of like all the things he's doing, he's a phenomenal guy. And
yeah,
just by following him and all of the things that he does has aroused my interest into thinking about what's a SpaceX, what do they do? And I kind of like kept on going and reading about this stuff. And when I think about it and the seriousness of what they are doing, the work that is going into it, and why we must even get to Mars, I think about it, I'm like, man, our future as a species is going to, like, there is a point where this is going to pay off.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And earlier in the show, you mentioned that there are people who have their own reservations about why we are pumping so much money and energy into this. But at some point in our history, we may not necessarily feel the impact now, like the positive impact now. But I feel at some point, and we talk about the greatest challenges that necessitate doing these things, like the mass extinction, for instance. And we've seen on the news sometimes they say, hey, there is a meteorite heading towards the Earth. There's one that just passed by the Earth and all of that. In those times, we realize that this was a good gift that the people of our age are leaving behind for the generation that will come after us.
Yeah.
It's an interesting thing to think about.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of changes and modifications that we must make for ourselves to be able to live there. And I was thinking about, I think we've talked about it a bit, but we'll probably shed more light on it, is what difference in lifestyle or whatever. We could be in lifestyle, in medical health, whatever. But what would be the difference between people living on Mars and those living on Earth?
Yeah.
And what would be the consequences of that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and like you said earlier, there's so much of this that is truly unknown. And I think the biological element is a huge factor, because there, in terms of the physics problems that we have to solve just to get up to Mars, there are extreme obstacles there, of course. There's laws of, you know, these Newtonian laws of physics that do prevent us from reaching this sort of science fiction level place where we can launch, you know, large number of people, extremely heavy cargo. Like, there's limits to what we're capable of, but we are capable. I do believe we will find a way to make those things happen. It's just that it's going to be a creative process. We're not just going to be able to go put more rockets, because the rocket boosters at some point will not equate to the thrust needed or the physics requirements needed. So we have to be creative in that sense, but that's a solvable problem. Biology, on the other hand, we have way less of a grasp on biology, even here on Earth.
Yes.
Physics on Earth, we have figured out pretty good. Biology is not, that's not the case. There's extreme unknowns still in the realm of biology. So I completely agree. That's a huge area of interest. And one other part that fascinates me is the problems and solutions that are going to come from this pursuit. So Elon, in his little keynote that he did, it's called Making Humans a Multiplanetary Species, on the SpaceX website, if you guys want to look it up. He presents like a little diagram that shows some of the differences between Mars and Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Mars is slightly smaller, but still pretty close. It's like two-thirds, about the size of Earth. The temperature ranges are slightly more extreme on Mars. So it can get to pretty cold, so negative 285 degrees Fahrenheit.
That's and very cold.
The peak temp is about 85. So it's habitable, but there's going to be obstacles there. The other big obstacle is that Mars's atmosphere and climate is extremely high in CO2. So Mars's atmosphere, I believe, is about 96% CO2 or something like that. And so developing a way to make that habitable, there's going to be these extreme challenges, but also we're going to see an exponential change in science and, you know, all sorts of things are going to come from this.
Yeah. We could go like on and on some of the key challenges that we are going to face by deciding and even wanting to go to a different planet. It's going to be a huge leap. And as you were talking, one of the things that also came to my mind is just the limitations that we have in just by living on this earth. Like, the things we know about this earth, the materials that we have, like the materials that we obtain from the core of the earth, like iron, like silica, like diamonds, all of those things we obtain because they are natural in the earth. When we get to Mars, some of the materials we will find, we will not even have names for them.
Right.
We would have to find names for those. We will find organisms. And there are a lot of, and I made mention of some of these programs. Some of these programs are there to do some research, to find some organisms, if there is any, even DNA that they could find on Mars. Right. To just trace back how those DNA means that it's linked to some organism that used to live there. Yeah. How did they live there? Yeah. Right. Some of these things will be so new to us, so new to us, that it's going to basically shape how we live life on Mars. And I believe these are interesting things to one, come, but we'll probably be ending the next
few minutes. One thing I just want, like with regards to both the moon and Mars, I think I would love to cover when we do part two a little bit more, is the harvesting of materials.
Yes.
Because as you said earlier in this episode, you know, the ability to mine, let's just say mine, for example.
Yeah.
We don't know the complete, excuse me, we don't know the complete composition of Mars. We don't know the complete composition of the moon. So, but there, I would venture to say that most likely there are going to be a lot of raw materials that are, that we on Earth are familiar with. And the ability to mine those things, especially if it turns out that there are more valuable materials up on these places, on the moon or on Mars, lithium, cobalt, these things that we want to incorporate in optimizing the Earth, but they cause a lot of issues here, even though they're helping develop electric vehicles, phone batteries, rechargeable systems, things that we deem to be clean energy. The reality is when you dig deep into how these things are made, it's very costly, and it's at the expense of oftentimes third world countries, individuals like that. So the ability to do this on a planet that's not directly impacting humans in such a negative way is really interesting.
Yeah. And my last words would on this, at least for this episode, because we would have a second episode where we look at commercial space flights or the technologies that are involved and go a little deeper into that. As a matter of fact, even the politics that goes into it, we'll probably talk about that a little bit. But on this episode, my last words would be, as far as just lunar exploration and Mars exploration is that we are setting ourselves up for great things to come, but it takes both this generation and the coming generation to work together, to collaborate.
Yeah.
And I like how, and as we mentioned earlier in the show, that scientists are able to put their differences behind them. They try so well to be able to leave politics out of academia. Mm. And by doing that, we are able to work together to research, to push the frontiers.
Yeah.
What would require going forward is that the institutions that are built up to help us to be able to accomplish these things, we would be able to take away the politics of those institutions too. Because like we mentioned NASA, for instance, NASA is funded by the US government.
Yeah.
And we mentioned the European Space Agency is funded by UK and all its allies.
Yep.
China also has its own. And so even though these scientists are working together, the politics of it becomes so difficult and would be the greatest challenge that we would face. And so going forward, we have a great shot at doing something so phenomenal, but we would be our own impediment in being able to accomplish the goals that we have when it comes to this space exploration.
No, I couldn't agree more. I think that really pushing ourselves to overcome that negative part of human nature to have strife and conflict, and I think the ego gets involved a lot when it's the ego of these political lines and stuff. That needs to, in order to succeed, that's definitely going to have to be handled or diminished as much as possible, like you said.
Yeah.
And I think just in terms of pursuing, like, looking into this stuff and discussing it and having a fascination with it, I think that it's valuable to, you know, believe that this stuff is possible. I believe it's valuable to pursue it as though it is possible.
Yeah.
Because it's only going to make you better. It's only going to make you a better scientist, or it's only going to open up your creativity. And so, yeah, it's really exciting stuff.
And on this note, we are going to draw the curtains on this episode, and we will be back on the second time to do a part two of this episode, and we'll continue with it. So stay tuned, subscribe if you've not subscribed on YouTube. And the Contemporary Science Podcast Show is also available on all your streaming platforms, Apple Podcasts, on Spotify. If you use an Android phone, you could also get it on Spotify or on Podcast Addict or anywhere you get your podcasts. My name is Randy E.T., your host, and I've been doing this with...
Sean Murphy, your co-host.
All right. See you another time. Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys.